Good morning, everyone. It is a blessing to be in the house of God. This is another day that the Lord gives us to praise Him, to rejoice in Him, to bring Him honor. And so if you would like to join, go ahead and stand to your feet. We are going to sing this very song called Grateful. And aren't we grateful for what the Lord has done? Have we all received something from the Lord this week? Yes? Yes? Okay. Can we see a show of hands? If you are grateful, can you raise your hand and say, I'm grateful? Yes. Look around you. Look at all those hands. We are all grateful. Now put it together. Yes.
This is the day that you have made. Whatever comes, I won't complain. For all my hope is in your name. And now your joy awaits my praise. I'll give thanks.
For that, Lord.
So here I stand. You are my God. Your faithfulness, my solid rock.
Let us give thanks.
I give thanks for all you have done. And I will sing of your mercy and your love. Your love is unfailing. Lord, I am grateful. I give thanks for as we lift our hands, the heavens open, heavens open.
Yes, they do.
So let our lives declare the love that God has spoken over us.
One more time.
And as we lift our hands, the
spoken love over us. Thank you, Jesus, for that. We receive it. Woo, give thanks.
I give thanks for all you have done, and I will sing of your mercy and your love. Your love is unfailing. Lord, I am grateful. I give thanks for all you have done. I won't forget all the
receive our worship. Receive our hearts, Lord, as a sacrifice of praise to you for the many things we have received, for the love you have spoken over us, Jesus. Thank you. Yes. Amen. Let us give the Lord a hand and let us be grateful. Please find your seat, and he is our pastor.
Good morning. Let me take this thing off. Well, you know, the last couple weeks, I think we all been acutely aware that not everybody has the freedom to worship like we do. And I was thinking about that this morning, how we have this great privilege of just coming in and saying whatever we want to say and singing whatever we want to say and praying the way we want to pray. And there's nobody going to stop us, and God is blessed by it. So I would hope that you would appreciate that a little more. I mean, all of us should. We take a lot of things for granted. Things become habit every Sunday we're here. And I just thought this morning I felt a nudge from God saying, you know, this is still a real blessing, what you do and who we are. That's why we do a confession. Yet it's to remind us of, you know, the joy and the peace and the privilege we have to worship God in spirit and in truth without hindrances. Today is communion. If you didn't get communion on the way in, we'll pass it around when it gets to it, but we use the Apostles' Creed as our reading. And it's from the history of the church, based on Scripture, and it speaks forth the truths that we believe and expect God to do. So let us read and let us believe. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into Hades. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Let's pray. God, we are grateful for your love, your mercy, and your forgiveness. We stand in awe that you are the maker of heaven and earth, and yet you chose to call us your children, to walk with us and to live in our lives, and to be with us for all eternity. Let us never forget the privilege and the honor to serve you and love you and to love others as you have loved them. And we thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay, so before we get started, I have a very important announcement to make. So our Christmas Carol dinner will be December the 18th, and folks, before you know it, it'll be here. So I'm not trying to rush you out to shop. What I'm trying to do is plant a seed in your heart. If you would like to help out with this ministry of playing the bells, or if you'd like to join us and sing, we can also do that. So anyone who is interested, you can see Kathy O, you can see me, let us know. Okay, we'd love to have you. It's a time of communion, and we'll figure out what that'll look like when the time comes, but we'd love volunteers. Okay, so let us stand and worship this song. This is Amazing Grace, and we are standing here today because of the Lord's amazing grace. So let us worship. Thank you, Lord, for that amazing grace.
The King of glory, the King of all kings. Who fills the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder.
The King of glory,
the King of all kings. This is amazing grace. This unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. Thank you, Lord. You laid down your life.
that you've done for me. Hey! Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, only the King of glory. This amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place. Thank you, Lord, that you would bear my cross. Boy, what a cross that was. You laid down your life, you know, with every sin of the world, that I would be set free. But he paid it all. Thank you, Lord. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Now can we say, worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. He did. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave and death. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, yeah, yeah. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. Unfailing, unrelentless, unending love. That you would take my place, Lord. Oh, that you would bear my cross. Ooh, you laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Of God, the Lord's amazing grace. Yes, give him a hand of praise if that's what you feel like doing. Say thank you, Jesus. And God is here indeed. And you know, we want you to help us out. You're going to be part of the worship team today. All you need to say is, oh. Can you say, oh? Okay, so that's all you need to know for a little while. So get ready to sing with your heart, with your mind, with all you got. Whoa. Jesus be revealed. Jesus be revealed. your kingdom. Yes, Lord, your kingdom. Open the heavens. Oh, pour out your spirit. Oh, Jesus, be revealed. Yes, Lord, Jesus, be revealed. Because you are here. God is here. God is here. God is here. He is able. We draw near to see Jesus face to face. God is here. God is here. God is here. He is faithful. We draw near to see Jesus. Oh, Jesus, be revealed. You say, your name, Lord. We cry hallelujah in his house. We say, holy, holy, hallelujah. Let us have a heart of worship this morning. Say, holy. We cry, holy. Hallelujah. God is here. Do you feel his presence? Do you feel him moving today? Holy. work. You know, whenever we can't see him, whenever we don't know what's happening, it's like a curtain where you cannot see through it, but the Lord is at work. The Lord is being revealed in the whole earth, not just in our community, but throughout the whole earth. So we got to trust in him and trust in his word. And you know, one of the blessings, as our pastor was saying, is the fact that we are in this place. We have the freedom to worship, the freedom to come together, to gather, and to seek the Lord and to play instruments. And up here, we're also blessed by, you see a lot more people this Sunday. We've had Frank since last week, and we have Theo back there again, and Chris and Carlos, and we are all part of this ministry, but so are you. Your voices, your hearts, your singing, your song of praise, that's what the Lord wants to hear most. You know, when you hear an instrument that is out of tune and it's being played, it's not really pleasing to our ear, Lord, right? So when the Lord hears us singing, it doesn't matter if you can't sing in tune, what he hears is the strings of your heart. And when you open it in worship, those strings sound beautiful. It is a pleasant scent before him that carries His presence wherever we go. And it's, you know, people can tell, sometimes they tell me, why are you different? You are just so different. Well, it's the presence of God in us that permeates everything we do and say. And today we can say we are no longer slaves. We have been set free by the power of Jesus Christ. You unravel me with a melody, surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies. To all my fears gone, I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. You say, I'm no longer a slave to fear, because I am your child. I am a child. God, child of the King, I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Oh, I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Lord, I am yours. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. You split the sea so I could walk right through it. My fears were drowned in perfect love. Oh, how many times have you done it for us? You rescued me so I could stand and sing. I am a child of God. You split the sea so I could walk right through it. You know, the Lord is still performing miracles, still parting the sea on our behalf. Oh, thank you, Jesus. You rescued me so I could stand and sing. I am a child of God. Say, I am a child. You split the sea so I could walk right through it. Oh, my fears were drowned in your perfect love, in your unending love. You rescued me so I could stand and sing. I am child of God. I am a child. I am a child of God. Yes, we are. I am a child of God. Oh, yes, I am a child of God. Thank you, Jesus, for that spirit. Thank you for that forgiveness. Thank you for your pardon that has been freely given, for the amazing grace that we are able to enjoy today in your presence that is with us, Lord. Thank you for being in this house. In Jesus' name, we thank you and pray. Amen. Please be seated.
Good morning, everyone. The readings for this morning come from the Old Testament, Psalms 89, 1 through 7, and the New Testament, John chapter 2, verses 12 through 25. I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. With my mouth, I will make your faithfulness known through all generations. I will declare that your love stands firm forever, that you have established your faithfulness in heaven itself. You said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to David, my servant. I will establish your line forever and make your throne firm through all generations. The heavens praise your wonders, Lord, your faithfulness too, in the assembly of the holy ones, for you in the skies above can compare with the Lord. Who is like the Lord among the heavenly beings? In the council of the holy ones, God is greatly feared. He is more awesome than all who surround him. John. After this day, he went down to Capernaum with his mother and brothers and his disciples. There they stayed for a few days. When it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple courts, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and others sitting at tables exchanging money. So he made a whip out of cords and drove all from the temple courts, both sheep and cattle. He scattered the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. To those who sold doves, he said, "Get these out of here. Stop turning my father's house into a market." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." Then Jews then responded to him, "What sign can you show us to prove your authority to do all of this?" And Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days." They replied, "It's taken 46 years to build this temple. Are you going to raise it in 3 days? But the temple he has spoken of was his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples recalled what he had said. Then they believed the scripture and the words that Jesus had spoken. Now while he was in Jerusalem at the Passover festival, many people saw the signs he was performing and believed in his name. But Jesus would not entrust himself to them, for he knew all people. He did not need any testimony about mankind, for he knew what was in each person." Shall we pray? Lord, as we consider today and your authority in it, we humbly ask the Holy Spirit to open our eyes, ears, and minds to what the Word is teaching. How will we apply it to our daily lives? There's so much more we could do, and yet there's so little we can do without you, Jesus. We ask you to bless Dennis as he speaks and clarifies this teaching today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Okay. First things first. There. Now I can talk. It was interesting as I was looking at this. You know, we'll be going through the Gospel of John, and some of it is not real deep theologically because it more is more narrative than it's teaching. It's to tell a story about Jesus, how he went, where he went, why he went, and then there is teaching, you know. What fascinated me about this is, you know, this is at the very beginning of Jesus's ministry. Most people that he's running into at this time, unless they've heard something, which probably not, they don't know who he is. You know, I mean, there's a lot of religious leaders, there's a lot of rabbis, there's a lot of members of the Sanhedrin, and Jesus is none of them. He doesn't have a formal title, he hasn't been trained. And so what we're seeing progressively is how Jesus comes into his ministry. We saw that it happened with John when the Spirit came upon him, that really birthed his anointing into what he was going to do. So we know from that moment on, really, Jesus is saying, listen, I'm just doing what God's telling me to do. There is a plan. We don't know what he knows, but he is obedient to God. And so he's taking each one of these steps. So after Canaan, he goes down to Capernaum. Now, this is 16 miles from Canaan to Capernaum. And it says it went down because Canaan is in the hill country. Capernaum is by the sea, but it's below sea level. So that's why they talk about him going down with his mothers and brothers and sisters. Now, obviously, to some, this would be controversial, depending on what your theological background is, when it talks about his brothers. The word they use could be his brother, could be his half-brother, could be his cousin, or even a brother-in-law. Now, traditionally, from the Protestant background, we believe that Mary had other children after Jesus. Catholics obviously do not believe that, but these are his followers, and the disciples are most likely the people that came to him from John the Baptist. You know, that's where his ministry first was birthed, disciples coming from John, and then he calls them under a tree and that type of stuff. So these people are traveling, and they said that at this time he's using Capernaum as his headquarters. This is where Jesus based his ministry on early in his career. He moves it about, but they're down there, we don't know how long, and then it says, when it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now, the Jerusalem is 76 miles away. I mean, think about this. I mean, I'm trying to figure out how far that is, you know. It's probably about halfway between Walnut Creek and Sacramento. You know, it's about 30, 40 miles to Walnut Creek. Now, you think about walking that distance with a group of people. You know, we always just think, well, Jesus is here and then he's here. Well, no, I mean, I wouldn't even want to walk from Canaan to Capernaum, 16 miles. But he did, and they had an entourage. And I thought, what do they do? How do they sleep? I mean, because when they come into a town, people don't know who he is. You know, this is, you know, we think about this, that everybody knew who Jesus was. Now, he did a miracle in Canaan, and not only that, think of the miracle, and you'll do during this teaching is, and I've never really understood this until recently, that Jesus isn't about changing water to wine. That's nothing for him. But he is changing paradigms. He's changing modes of thinking. He's changing what coming from the Old Testament to the New Testament. That's what he's about. He didn't get, you know, God didn't send him down to earth to do parlor tricks and change water to wine, sleight of hand or something. He's to establish a kingdom. And that kingdom is radically different than the Old Testament. And each step, when we start seeing Jesus having public ministry, he is not attacking the Old Testament, but fulfilling the Old Testament with new revelation. And that revelation is for us. The old ways are not for us. The new ways are for us. And so that's what he's doing. So they finally get to Jerusalem. Now, some of you, if you read other gospels, you'll find out that this story is at the end of Jesus' life in other gospels. John puts it at the beginning of his life. And most scholars think that there might have been three or four Passovers that went on during Jesus's life, and that there might have been more than one cleansing of the temple. Because you'll remember in Matthew, when he cleanses the temple and says, this should be a house of prayer, those words, and tear down the temple, I'll raise it back up, those words were used in his trial against him. He said that if we tear down the temple, he'll build it in 3 days. So they want to accuse him of blasphemy. Well, if it happened 2 or 3 years earlier, and it was this, you know, the people around probably wouldn't remember what he'd said, but it was recently. So they think there might be two different incidents, you know, and you have to understand this. When you read the New Testament, if you critically think or somebody says something, there is discrepancies between them on the surface. It's usually when you read the historical criticism and all that stuff, you see that there are things they understand by what he said that would put this in order. It's not, you know, John's making it up or Matthew's making it up. They could be two totally different. But this is what happens. So he says he comes up to where the Jews are in the temple courts, where men were selling cattle, sheep, doves, and others sitting at tables exchanging money. You know, now Jesus comes in, and obviously we're going to know what he wants, but you know, to say it, this is the outer court. This is the court of Gentiles. People were allowed in there. There's an outer court and inner court, and the inner court also has the Holy of Holies. So these people could come into this, especially proselytes that had converted to Judaism, and they would come to the outer court, and they were prepared to give a sacrifice. That's where it was. So, but what happened is both the Roman and Greek coins that they used had the image of usually Caesar on them. So they were not accepted in the temple. You know, this really is legalism. So what they had was money changers. You give me your money and denarii and drachmas, and I will give you the temple coin, which is a half a shekel, and you can use that to pay for your sacrifice. So there was commerce going on in the court here. And a lot of people have used this in churches to say we can't have fundraisers or bake sales or stuff like that. This is not what Jesus is talking about. He isn't saying, well, you shouldn't be doing this because it's commerce. No, what he's saying is you have replaced the practices of the church with commerce. And now it's commerce. And that's what he is talking about. And he's very upset by it. Now, some people believe this couldn't have happened because they would have never let the animals in the outer court. And the reason why is because if they ever broke free, they could get into the inner court, and that was strictly forbidden. So some people believe that it was caught outside, but Jesus comes in and he sees these people. He gets very angry. Now remember, they probably don't know who he is, you know, because like he said, he's maybe weeks before he's done the miracle in Canaan, but how long does it take for information to get from there 76 miles away? You know, they don't have the internet, they don't have newspapers, they don't have, you know, CNN or Fox. So they may not have heard. They probably first heard of it was when they arrived in Jerusalem from the disciples and the followers. And so you have Jesus's brothers and his disciples and some followers. Some were fascinated by Jesus. I mean, if you met a man who turned 120 gallons of water into wine, you may follow him too. And that is common. And we'll see why it's a problem, but not right at this moment. So he gets in and he decides to cleanse the temple. Now, realize that no stick or no weapon was allowed in the temple. So they believe he might have taken reeds from the beds for the cattle and woven them together, you know, because he doesn't have, you know, people just weren't armed in there. It was against the rules. And he drives them out and he goes, get out of here. Now, most of the time, it's considered that he never beat people. You know, basically he was, you know, throwing and yelling and, I mean, whipping a thing around. Because otherwise they'd say, well, how can he be God if he's beating people? Well, he probably wasn't, because he had this thing. Now, we're going to see why this is so important in a second. So he whips them and he gets them outside. And then it says, to those who sold doves, he said, get out of here. How dare you turn my father's house into a marketplace? Now, this is an Old Testament scripture and a house of prayer. And it says, will you steal and murder, commit adultery and perjure, burn incense to Baal, and follow other gods you have not known, and come and stand before me in this house, which bears my name, and say, we are safe to do all these detestable things? Has this house which bears my name become a den of robbers to you? But I have been watching you declares the Lord, Jeremiah 7:11. So they, most Jews at this time, and some people that have converted, are very well versed in the Old Testament, Psalms, Jeremiah. They hear the stories, and this is where this comes from. Jesus will always be quoting the Old Testament because he's going to fulfill it and change it. And so this is what he's talking about. This is supposed to be a house of prayer, and we'll talk about that. So Jesus comes as a prophet and as the Messiah. That's who they think he is. So it gives him an authority to do this, as in that position. If he was the Messiah, he could do whatever he wanted in the house of God because it's his house. And so the Jews at the time, they say, well, who gives you authority to do this? Who are you to say this should be a house of prayer? We know in Isaiah 56, it says, and give them joy in my house of prayer. But some believe he's doing away with the temple. We've talked about this before. The three pillars of the Old Testament were the temple, the law, and the covenants. Jesus will change all three of those things, not doing away with them, but he will fulfill them. The temple will become him. You know, the law becomes grace. The covenants is a new covenant. And Jesus is trying to teach them this. These are people steeped in the Old Testament, and they think, well, Jesus is here to fulfill the law. Well, he's not here to enforce it. He's here to say, I can change it because I wrote it. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. So this is what he's saying. But the Jews say, well, okay, that, you know, we understand who you do, but who gives you the authority to do this? And so he changes what happens to them. And he replaces the temple as the center for worship. He wants to remove those worldly aspects and practices from the house of prayer. This is Father's house. This is where worship goes on. And when it talks about the house of prayer, it's not talking about all you can have in the temple is a prayer meeting. Prayer is to them being in God's presence, whether it's talking or listening or worshiping or giving thanks. The house of prayer meant that it was God's house. His presence was there, even though at this time it only comes once a year in the holiest of holies, but it is supposed to be reverent for that. And he's saying, you've changed it, but I want to reestablish what it's supposed to be to you because I am the center. It's changed. The temple isn't the center of your worship. In this new paradigm, it's me. You know, so realize when we talk about the world and the kingdom, you know, we're always, most pastors, preachers are always, you know, comparing the two. Are you worldly? You know, the world says this, don't have worldly thinking or this or that. And we compare the two. Jesus is not trying to compare the two. He's not saying the world is bad. He's not trying to tell you that, you know, everything that we've done in the Old Testament is failure. What he's trying to say is, listen, just for a moment, erase everything. Let me tell you what is happening now. Don't compare. Don't think it up. I mean, if you really want to understand the kingdom of God, only God can reveal it to you. You're not going to get it by your common sense. He's not going to get it by your thought patterns. It's going to have to be revealed to you because we're not just talking about a new way of living with a new set of rules. We're talking about an existence that has never, ever been done before. The Old Testament was the first example of how we can get to God, but Jesus is saying, I'm trying to establish and show you what it's going to be like, and I'm going to change these basic things. And his disciples said they remembered his zeal for the house will consume me. That's Psalm 69:9. Now, we don't know if they remembered this or not, you know, because when John writes his gospel, it's at the end of Jesus has gone, been ascended. So when he remembers things, you know, like we said, what do you think they did traveling from here to Jerusalem from Capernaum? How long did that take? I mean, even if they went 7, 8, 10 miles a day, it'd take a week. Well, what did they do during that week? Jesus isn't silent during this time. that we know he would be teaching his disciples and explaining things to them. And if anybody knew the Old Testament, it was Jesus. He could probably quote every scripture in the Old Testament. So when his consumption, I'm sure afterward they say, one of them, I would think, now this is just my theory, I'm not trying to teach this as, you know, truth, but I'm sure one of the disciples would say, whoa, why'd you do that? You know, do you know you're treading on thin ice, you know, taking up a whip in the temple? And I'm sure he would probably quote this scripture and say, listen, let me explain. This is my Father's house. And when I came into my Father's house, I expected people to be respectful and loving and trying to worship God in spirit and truth. And what I saw was sheep and goats and doves and money changers. It just turned into, you know, it could have been a bank or a wholesale warehouse. And I'm consumed because of my love for God. Remember, I and God are one. How could I react any less than that type of compassion? So I'm sure he taught him. So later on when John would write this, he'd go, oh man, we knew. You know, why did we know? Because he taught us these things. Jesus wants to continually teach you new things and reveal it to you. And then the Jews demanded him, saying, well, what miraculous sign do you show us to prove your authority to do this? So to them, if you got the juice, you got to do it. I mean, we're willing to believe in you if you perform. That's what they wanted to know. And there's a difference in the Greek between power. There's two words for power as it's exercised, dunamis and exousia. Dunamis is what we get dynamite from, and it means power, you know, force. But exousia is authority, you know, and the only example I've ever used, and it makes sense to me, is I have the power to write a $1 million check to you. I don't have the authority to write it. And when you go to the bank, you'll find out. See, the authority to do something is different than the power. And what they wanted was to see the power. Jesus was not interested in the power. He was interested in the authority. So, and a lot of this will come through your whole Christian life. You know, when you meet things and when you pray for things, are you just, that's why a lot of times you'll see people when they're praying for stuff, especially I've witnessed this a lot when you're, you know, I've been at quite a few exorcisms. So you can always tell the difference between the people that are new at it because they have to yell and scream as if they're trying to intimidate the devil or the demon. I don't think it works. But there's some who just speak and things happen. Why? Because they're walking in God and they have the authority to do it. Jesus always had the authority. You know, look at the sons of Sceva. You know, we prayed for these people and all of a sudden the demons came out and they stripped us and beat us up and threw us out. But we prayed in Paul's name and Jesus' name. Well, you may have thought you had the power. Maybe you did at that time have the power. But when Jesus cast them out, there was no question. There was no demon ever beat Jesus up. Why? Because he had full authority. All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. And this is really important because the world is shooting at one thing. Jesus is shooting at another thing, saying, you got to rethink this stuff. It's not about how much power you think you have, but how much authority has God given you or do you trust God for that is going to change your life? You know, the power, we whip it up. I've always wondered about that, how people, you know, scream and yell I understand when people are being delivered that they may scream and yell when things come out of them, but for people that pray for them, it doesn't have to be that way, you know, because it's not going to work. So they said, okay, and even later on, it says some of the people believed because he did signs and wonders later on. So Jesus answers them and he says, destroy this temple and I will raise it up in 3 days. He did not say, I will build it up in 3 days. Jesus, I mean, come on. I mean, I don't know, maybe he could, but he's not trying to say, and that we don't know how long the temple took to build. Historical things in the Bible sometimes are hard to prove. It might have been 45 years, it might have been 48 years. It might have been done at this time, it may not have been finished. But what Jesus is saying is on a different level. They don't understand. And most of the time, it says that the things of the Spirit are foolish to the natural mind. And a lot of times when we teach spiritual truths or try to enlighten people into them, we speak on a level they understand on a different level. And that's why there's conflict all the time. Have you ever tried to witness to somebody and you're trying to talk about who Jesus is and they're just asking questions that just don't make sense because they're not thinking on a spiritual plane. Now, whether they can or not, that I don't know. But Jesus is talking about totally different. He's not talking about, blow this temple up and I'll come back with my hammer and saw and in 3 days I'll build this whole thing back up. He says, no, I'll rise it up. And he's not talking about the temple as they know it, Old Testament. He's talking about the temple as he knows it, New Testament. And some people believe that the temple represents the church. Some people believe it represents new creation. Some people believe that the resurrection of Jesus. But when Jesus is talking about this, he's talking about the temple being the architectonic center of worship in the pattern revealed by God. In the Old Testament, it was. In the New Testament, it is Jesus. Always. Without any thoughts. Everything about worship, everything about the holiness, everything about the presence, everything comes back to only Jesus. And that's what he's talking about. He says, I'll raise it up. You may destroy it. And he's talking about what's going to happen to him. And this is kind of that idea of spirit and flesh. We're going to see it in the next chapter with Nicodemus. You must be born again. What? I got to go back in my mom's womb? Jesus says, no, you're not listening to me. I'm not talking about going back in your mother's womb. I'm talking about being born again spiritually. So they have this dialogue, and a lot of times this is what will happen to you. You have to be careful and pay attention because sometimes people will answer you in the physical, and that's okay. That's maybe all they understand. But you have to understand this dynamic is going on. Jesus, at this time in his life, especially when he's starting to teach and reverse things, it's almost always this way because he's speaking at a level nobody even understands. Now, remember, these disciples and followers are not Christians as we would define a Christian because Jesus has not died and been resurrected. The sins of humanity have not been forgiven yet. That's why Jesus doesn't call people Christians or call that way, because he's supposed to teach what the kingdom is, how to live it, what he expects, and then at the end of his life, he dies to seal your entrance into the kingdom. You can only come in through him and by him. And he was down here to say, that's why he doesn't do a lot of evangelistic type messages, because that's not what he's supposed to do. It's not accessible to them yet. And we need to understand that, because we always tend to look back at these things that John and Matthew and them are all born again Christians following Jesus. And they're not, folks. They're human beings struggling with knowing that this man is different. We believe he's the Messiah, and we don't understand what that means. And every time he does something, we don't understand. They don't understand this. And they didn't understand Canaan. You're the Messiah. So what is your first act? Making wine. Sometime have a Baptist try to explain that to you. So Jesus is restructuring things. He's restructuring relationships to God, how we enter the chosen race, where it is, what it is, and what true worship is, and how we will live as new creation. But the temple he had spoken of was his body, and it was raised from the dead. And the disciples recalled when they believed the scripture and the words Jesus had spoken regarding the temple. Okay, and so this verse is revealing that new dimension. Now, while he was in Jerusalem, a Passover feast, many people saw the miraculous signs he was doing and believed in his name, but Jesus would not entrust himself to them because he knew all of humanity. He did not need man's or woman's testimony about him, others, for he knew what was in humanity. These people believed on his name, and he didn't trust them. We all talk about this as salvation, you know. Well, you just got to believe on Jesus' name, and the name means the character, who he is, what they've done. That's when to believe in somebody's name is that. And these people believed on his name, but Jesus said, man, no, not yet. These people really don't understand who I am or what I'm going to do or how it's going to be done. You know, the disciples think, oh, well, this is great. And these people now... Most of us think that Jesus would, you know, maybe do a miracle a day or something like that, or every week, you know, because they're highlighted. But this is in the very beginning of his ministries, and it talks about he's in Jerusalem, you know, and this could be just like a month after his baptism, and he's doing miracle works all the time. And people are, you know, amazed at this stuff enough to believe in him because they're hungry for the Messiah. It's been 300 years since God has spoken to the Jewish nation, and they are hungry to hear and know something from God. They heard the old stories. They heard about Moses, you know, and the pillar of fire and the Red Sea. They heard about all these things, but they've been dry for a long time. So when somebody comes along and says he represents God and their people around him are calling the Messiah, they're hungry for it. And when they see him do miraculous things, they believe. But Jesus is more interested in, if you believe, how has it changed you? You know, we were on tour one year, and we were touring the United States and with musicals and stuff. And whatever city we'd come in, we had like 40 kids, and then we'd work with local churches. So we would go out, and we decided to take a survey because we were in like 10 different states. So we would ask people two questions. Do you believe that Jesus was the Messiah? And about 80 to 85% said yes, believe it or not. I mean, I don't think people would, now they'd probably say no, but, you know, we're talking in the 80s, people would just say yes, whether they believe it or not, but because it was common. But then we would ask him, and what effect does that have on your daily life? And it went down into the teens of how many people. See, this is what we're talking about. You may believe Jesus is the Lord. You may believe he's the Messiah. You may believe he died for your sins. But to really be confident that you are in the family, it would have to have changed your life. When the natural meets the supernatural, something changes, and it's not the supernatural. You know, when we come into prayer, the house of prayer, with God, prayer changes us. It doesn't change God at all. There's nothing you can pray about that he doesn't know. He knows what he's going to do. He's inviting us in so as we come in and feel comfortable with God and feel the peace and being able to share that thing, we are changed by the presence of God. And that's what Jesus is trying to see. That's why it ends this way. So everyone is looking for something new. You know, we're looking for new worship, new services, new prophetic words, new healings, new inner healings, you know, prayer methods. You know, we're always looking for something new, as if the kingdom of God advances, you know, not in the advance like taking on what the Bible says, but advances like everything has to become new. But it's not true. There's a lot of old things in the kingdom of God that doesn't change. You know, Jesus isn't out to just change everything and say, forget that stuff, we're going to start a whole new thing. He honors the past and improves with the new. So you're called to what? Love God with all your mind, heart, and soul, and love your neighbor as yourself. That hasn't changed. There's nothing new about this, you know. And that's one of the reasons that Jesus is trying to establish new creation. In new creation, you will become like a person that follows the commandments, not because you have to, but because you want to, because you're in love with Jesus. He's trying to establish that in the Old Testament. And what God's present comes to it in the Old Testament once a year, but he wants it to be with us every day because his house of prayer is the right to talk to listen to sit in his presence and worship him. And it's not in a temple. I don't have to go to the temple. I don't have to go to the church to pray. I don't have to go here to seek God's presence. Now, I can seek God's presence here, but I don't have to. But to Jesus, one of the big things about the house that he overturns is, in the Old Testament, it was a house of prayer. So how do we pray like Jesus told us to pray? A lot of people are confused about prayer. I know people that won't pray out loud. I know people that shouldn't pray out loud. But it's a different thing than we think of. Jesus says, I'll teach you how to pray. Now, who can instruct you better to pray than Jesus? I mean, I can't even imagine what went on in his mind when him and the Father are one. I can't even imagine what that would be like. I mean, I felt God's presence. I felt God's words. I felt, you know, feeling close to God, but I've never felt me and God are one. You know, like there's nothing breaking us down. And you have a right to feel that. You're not going to become Jesus. But he says, you know, that in John 17, everything that he has and is given is to bring us into participate in Peter. And Peter is to participate in the divine nature. He's not holding anything back, but we have to learn how to pray how he prays. Now, it's in Matthew 5. I always go back to the Sermon on the Mount because I believe that is just pivotal for everything. And it's amazing that it is pivotal. Matthew puts the Lord's Prayer in the middle of the Sermon on the Mount. There's 116 verses before and 114 verses in Greek after, right in the middle. I'm going to teach you how to pray, but I'm going to teach you how to pray because of the sermon it is. Now, he first starts off with just two rules about anti-rules about prayer. He said, I'll tell you what, before you learn to pray, don't pray for show and don't go on and on. Those are simple rules. You know, don't try to impress people with your prayer. Don't try to impress God. You know, I have been in groups where people would only pray in King James. I thought, what, doesn't God understand English like, you know, we talk? Or does it have to be these and thous and arts? Because somehow somebody has taught them that that's how God is. You know, it's not a show, folks. You know, I've been in groups recently where it was on Zoom and it was people from all over the world. And when you get that kind of audience, the people that pray seem to somehow want to impress people around them with their theology. So in their prayer, they go through their teachings to impress other people. Do you think God is impressed with that? Do you think God is really concerned about what you think about things? Not in a negative way, but in a positive way. He wants to hear your heart. He knows what you're going to pray, but he wants to feel that heartfelt thing. You know, what are you burdened about? It even says there sometimes when we pray, all we can do is groanings that can't be uttered. Have you ever been weeping or hurt or traumatized so much you don't even know how to pray? But God does. He knows what your heart is. So he says, first of all, you know, don't make a show of it and don't go on and on. You know, you don't have to pray for 15 minutes to ask God to help you with your finances. And you don't have to instruct God on how to do it. You know, a lot of people do, oh, God, I want you to pray for so-and-so. I want you to heal them. And you need to really touch their arm, and then you really need to make it whole, and you need to do this, you need to do that. God knows what he's doing. He knows, and he's going to be motivated by you have a burden for somebody that needs healing. And we talked about it last week about hearing God. Listen the way he wants to do it. Not the way you want to do it. God, this person's life is messed up. I don't know what is going on, but you do. Teach me how to pray for them. So that's what Jesus says. Don't try to impress them and don't go on and on. Now, some people will say, like even the Lord's Prayer, well, we can't say that because it's repetitive and it goes on and on. No, it doesn't. It takes about a minute. You could pray it every day of your life. It would not be repetitive. And Jesus is not about repeating. I pray for certain things every night. I have a list. I can go through it, detail by detail, everything, every night, the same people, same need. There's nothing wrong with that. I don't think God gets tired of hearing it. I think God is warmed by it because I trust God with those things because I can't do anything about them. So God is not worried about how long you talk or do you repeat a prayer. You know, there was 18 sayings in the Jewish, in early Christianity. And a lot of the church fathers would pray it two or three times a day. People used to pray a lot more than they do now. You know, most of the time when God talks to us, we figure something out and then go to prayer. Okay, God, I just heard a bad doctor's report. I better call my doctor. Or better yet, let me go to the internet because the internet MD will tell me what to do. And instead of bowing my head and said, God, I don't know what to do. Help me. So that's what Jesus is talking about. So in the Lord's Prayer, we all say it. We say it at the end of communion. And God wants us to do certain things. The Lord's Prayer, you can pray word for word. There's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing, don't be intimidated by it. But the concept Jesus is saying, I'm going to teach you how to pray, is bigger than the Lord's Prayer. It's not just these things that you need to pray for. He talks about going to a room and close the door and locks it, and it's a storage room. Believe it or not, in the Old Testament, the temple, where is God's presence? In the holies of holies, the most holy place on earth at that time. Where's the storehouse? It's probably the most unclean room in a house. It's got animals in it, it's got food in it, it's got all sorts of things. But there's one thing about it that it has that none of the other rooms usually had, a lock. Go in and lock the door. Now, Jesus doesn't want you to have to find a place and lock yourself in a room. I mean, I have a prayer place and other people haven't. That isn't it. But what he wanted was you got to get away and quiet yourself. Find that place. If it's in your car, if it's in your house, if it's at work, wherever it is, in your mind, quiet yourself and come to me. The surroundings don't matter. The heart matters. And so he tells them that he's going to change them. Remember, Jesus believes in quality, not quantity. You know, the quality, the heartfelt of your need. So they used to say, make your prayer brief, frequent, and intense. And pray like this, Jesus tries to tell them on the Sermon on the Mount. So what he's going to do is he's going to give them two groupings of three petitions. These are what is important to you. And I'll go through them very quickly because we have communion. He has three that are yours. Your. Hallowed be thy name. Those things. And then three of them have to do with us. So the first thing is our Father who art in heaven. He's talking about when you say this, do you understand when he said, our Father? Jesus is giving you access to address God as he would. The term is Abba. It's one of the most intimate terms. Father has a lot of terms in the New Testament, in Greek and stuff. But what Jesus is doing is giving you permission to pray our Father like he would. And let me tell you, when Jesus prays, God listens, I believe. But he's saying he's going to listen to you too because he's our Father. And not only does he ask you to pray like he would pray, but how everyone else prays. You're not alone in this. There's not super spiritual and unspiritual. If you believe, he's your Father. And the person next to you, if they believe, it's their Father. It's very important for us to understand the intimacy we have with God through Jesus and through other people. Our Father who art in heaven. This is not talking about him being just in heaven. It talks about him being in the skies, everywhere. And we just said it at the very beginning. You know, you created heaven and earth. Where is God? Everywhere. When you pray, you need to understand that. You know, I can pray for Afghanistan. I've never been there. But God's there. And I have to have the faith to understand that when I'm praying for things, that God is everywhere. Hallowed be thy name. And that talks about, you know, our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. You're holy. You're wonderful. You're powerful. You're unique. Your name is above all names. I'm not just praying to a God. I'm praying to the God. And so when I address myself in prayer, I stand there and say, my gosh, he's my daddy. And he's everywhere. And I asked my dad for all sorts of things when I was young. And I, you know, sometimes he'd give them to me, sometimes he wouldn't. But I'd ask. But he had limited power, limited funds, limited emotions. But when we pray, Jesus tells us you need to stand in the position of realizing you're praying to your Father who has no limitations. So we pray for our Father. Hallowed be thy name. Second petition is your kingdom come. When we're praying, we have to realize that God has a kingdom. He has a realm. That's what kingdom means, the rule and realm of God. Your kingdom come. Not only are we praying for God's kingdom to come to earth, but you're also praying for God to use you in the kingdom. God, change my heart so I'm a kingdom thinker, a kingdom doer. Because sometimes we can talk, you know, I can pray for, oh God, we want, you know, that church. It's weird. Your kingdom's got to come down. And I'm sure Jesus would stand there and say, what about you, Dennis? You know, you're just as weird to me as they are. You know, you have to change your heart. Your kingdom come in every situation. God, we want your kingdom because we don't fully understand it. It covers social justice. It covers hurts. It covers war and pestilence. We are praying down God's kingdom because remember in the New Testament, and this is something we totally forget today, most every scripture John wrote and other books, especially Paul, they were all written with the idea that Jesus was coming back soon. That was their hope. Their hope wasn't to get better. Their hope wasn't to change the world. Their hope was, God, let me hold on until you come. And they expected him back. So when they're praying the kingdom come, they're expecting it to come powerfully soon. And they never lost that hope. And that is very important. So they pray for this context in the name of Jesus, you know, or in the power. The third one is your will be done. Your name be holy, your kingdom come. And then the last one, your will be done. What is God's will? We talked about this. I believe it's in the Sermon on the Mount and the Beatitudes. That's what God wills for the earth. He wills for people to be like the Sermon on the Mount. That's what new creation is. Why did he come? He didn't just come to save you so you go to heaven. He came down to establish a kingdom where men and women rule in it with the character of Jesus. That's his will. And besides that, his will is still going on in heaven. He's still doing things. Folks in heaven, we don't understand what they are, but we want him to your will be done. And what does he say? On earth as it is in heaven. That's what our pattern is. I don't know what all of heaven is like. I mean, most of the time we just think that up there all they do is sing holy, 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 and they stand around, worship God, and that's it. And is that what we're praying? I don't think so. I don't think that I'm praying, God, I just hope that someday everybody just stands on their feet. They never go to work. They never eat. They never sleep. They just say, holy, holy, holy. I don't think that's what I'm praying or should be praying. What I should be praying is, God, somehow those characteristics that are in heaven, the love, the compassion, the wholeness, the reconciliation, those things would come down and be established on earth. But they can't be established on earth unless you establish them in your life first. So you are a vehicle of that type of thing. So then in the middle, he says, as earth it is in heaven. Remember, the kingdom is cosmic, folks. It's literal, but it's cosmic. It's all over. And so we complete this first table. It says your name, your kingdom, your will. You know, Paul talks about faith, hope, and love, right? So we are praying for the hallowness of God's divine name with faith. We're praying for the kingdom to come in hope, and we're praying for God's will for us through love. And now the petition changes, Jesus says. Okay, you've established the right thing, who God is, what his name is, what his character is, where he is, his power, his authority, and that we want that power to come to earth, and we want it to rain down in people's hearts. So now we're going to talk to personally, and this is where you can pray. It says, give us this day our daily bread. What is our daily bread? Our daily bread is not bread, folks. It's food, health, body, weather, home, house, children, good government, peace. Everything you need to live and exist, or any human, that's what he's praying for. And you pray for it for one day. You know, don't get technical on me, but, you know, basically, God, just get me through this day with the things I need. Now, most of us don't need to pray for a lot of this. You know, we have all these things. There's a lot of people in the world that don't. You know, and I'm not trying to make you feel guilty, but I'm just saying Jesus teaches us to make sure that we're reliant on God and not ourselves. It's easy to become reliant on our bank accounts, our talents, our age, our education, or our job, or anything else. What he says is those things are not bad. Jesus is not against all this stuff, but what he wants to say at your core being, are you reliant on God? Do you trust God to know, even though you don't know the future, God does? But he said, this is what we want. And he also wants to pray, you know, when the give us our daily bread is to really protect us against things that are not good, pestilence, war, all that stuff. And it's interesting because he uses the word bread, not cake, because he's not talking about luxuries. He's talking about necessities. That's what God wants you to have. I mean, there's nothing wrong with luxuries, folks, but God is not the, you know, the Santa Claus that gives you everything you want. There are theologies that say that, and God does sometimes bless you in certain ways. It's amazing. There's nothing wrong with that, but what we're saying is, God, I want my life to exist, everything coming from you, for the day will come when we need to have the world understand that true bread or facilities come from God. Now, the interesting thing here, and most people never thought about it, I didn't, Jesus says, give us our daily bread before he says, forgive us our sins. Because Jesus knows if you're hungry and starving, it's pretty silly to talk about spiritual things. People need to be taken care of first. And sometimes Christians especially don't think about that. They just think about preaching the gospel. That's all they need. They just need Jesus. Well, that's true. But I had a young kid come into me. They used to always give me the difficult cases. So this mother brought her son in and said, he's hearing voices. Oh, great. So I said, okay. I prayed and I thought, so what do they want me to do? A deliverance, okay? I said, how long has it been since you slept? He said, I don't know, man. I'm hearing voices. I've been up for like 2 or 3 days. Really? And how long has it been since you've eaten? Well, I've eaten for 2 or 3 days. I'm all wound up. I'm hearing voices. You got to get rid of this. I said, no, I'll tell you what. I said, this is my advice. Take your kid down to McDonald's. Buy him a couple of hamburgers and something to drink. Take him home. Let him go to bed. And if he wakes up and he hears voices, bring him back here and we'll deal with it. She did that. Never came back. Kid had got so wound up he wasn't eating or sleeping. And after 3 days, you're going to hear something. But see, it was a physical need. You have to learn there's physical needs, there's emotional needs, there's psychological needs, and there's spiritual needs. And you can't minister to one and bypass the other one. You know, you may want to minister to spiritual needs, but if it's a physical need, it's something different. If it's an emotional need, you just can't, you know, how many people say, oh, you have a problem? Well, just pray and God will get rid of it. No, it may not be. Maybe they need a hug. Maybe they need inner healing, and God wants you to be the vehicle to bring that to them, and he will do it, but learn to discern what it is. That's what prayer is about. Give us our daily bread so we remember what to do, and as he says, it comes that way, and he says, forgive us our, John is more the failures. than sins or debts or whatever, or trespasses. We've talked about this. And today when we do the Lord's Prayer after communion, I would ask you to say, Lord, forgive us our failures as we forgive those who fail against us. See, because they believe that John, debts and trespasses and other things historically had more to do with sins of commission. John is more interested in sins of omission, of God, forgive us for the things that we should have done that we haven't done. And forgive those people that should have done us a certain way that didn't. You know, it's a lot harder to be forgiven of sins of omission. Because, not for God, but for us, because it's something that we didn't do and we don't know what the effect was. I mean, if I go out and beat somebody up, I know what the effect is. But if there was somebody in need and God told me to go minister to them and I didn't, we don't know what the results were. And I've had tragic things. I've had been told to go talk to people and I said I'd do it on Monday and they died over the weekend. I know what that feels like. That was a sin of omission. And when I asked God and I felt terrible about it, he said, listen, it's not on you, but next time I tell you to do something, I expect you to do it. You don't know what the reason is. I do. So that's why we say, God, forgive us for our failures. There's a lot of things we should be doing we're not. And help us to forgive all those people. I mean, a lot of us want love, security, caring from other people. A lot of times we don't get it. We need to forgive them for that, to walk in that forgiveness. So we forgive humanity so we can become the human beings God wants us to become. And we forgive those who failed us. And this forgiveness is an aorist word in Greek. It means once and for all. When you forgive somebody, it's over and done. This is amazing. Somebody recently, I read this thing. Well, when you confess to Jesus his name or something, he forgives you all your sins and remembers them no more. He forgot them all. No, God doesn't forget your sins. God can't forget things. How can he make him, when he's all-knowing, forget things? What it means is that he will never hold it against you. When you confess a sin, as far as God's concerned, it's done with. I'm never going to hold it. You know how people are sometimes. You always do this. How come you've been saying that to me for 20 years? Do I ever get forgiveness? Or every time you get mad, you bring up something that happened 20 years ago. See, God would never do that. And this is what this is talking about. God isn't going to forget all these things, but he's just going to say, I don't have to hold you against it. So when you forgive somebody, you need to do the same thing. Because it's very important. The sixth petition is, and don't lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. You know, this is an amazing prayer. Starts with God, ends with the devil. And it really does in there. For thine is the power and the glory and honor forever and ever. That was added. It wasn't in the original. And interesting, this is important in prayer. It doesn't say, or it should not say, and lead us not into temptation. God doesn't lead people into temptation. What it should say is, please, don't let us be led into temptation. Who leads you into temptation? The evil one. Demons, the world, all evil people, race, you know, whatever, racism, all sorts of systemic evil. Those are the things that lead you into temptation. God doesn't do it. So you're not saying, God, please, while you're leading me, don't make me go down a road that's going to, I'm going to end up in destruction. God says, I don't do that. But what you should be is praying for protection that you don't get led that way. Because there's all sorts of things that want to lead you that way. And Jesus says, if you're going to pray, just pray, God, please, let me not be led. Help me to realize when I'm being led and to understand it and to clarify it to me so I'm not led. Because the evil one, I don't care if you believe in the devil as a personality or, you know, a person or a demon. You know, some people don't even believe it exists. He does. And the Bible is very clear. Jesus is very clear. It's a being. And his motive is to destroy the world from having a relationship with God. So he's going to do what he can to get you away from God. If he can't get you, if you're saved, we're reformed, so we believe in ultimate forgiveness, and it's for lifetime. He's not going to try to do that, but he's going to try to stop you from being an effective Christian. He's going to try to stop you from growing and maturing and learning new things in the kingdom. That's what he's going to do. You know, it's kind of like, well, you know, I can't stop somebody's kid from being a kid of a parent, but I can influence that kid to hate his parents. See, that's what he's trying to do. And in your life, that's what he's trying to do. And so what Jesus is praying is, you know, you need to be led away from the evil one, because God is trying to do this miraculous work with a new kingdom. The enemy is trying to destroy all the works of the kingdom in you. That's why the petition is, God, please don't let me be led in temptation or by the evil one, but deliver us from the evil one. So we should avoid this. And we want to be led in such a way to resist the temptations around us. And God, we're praying that you come down and rescue us from the ways of the evil one so we can know your power and your divine help. So now we've talked about the second half is give us, forgive us, and lead us. Not just in words, but also the concepts of who God is, where he is, what does he want us to do, how he wants to supply us, how he wants to forgive and restore, how he wants to be our protector, and how we are to be his beings for his glory. That's what Jesus is teaching. That is what prayer is about. He uses these words, which you can use, but it works a lot better when you understand why he gave these words. They're powerful. They're long. They're amazing to teach you to pray who God is, what he wants to do, and what he wants us to be. Let's pray. God, we're grateful for your love and your mercy. We're amazed that no matter what we know, there's always so much more to know. And you're not a harsh taskmaster. You don't want to rebuke us and say we're silly or we don't understand. You're always there to love us, to encourage us, and to forgive us so that we can become more like you. It's not about getting better or being smarter or powerful. It's about being at peace in the kingdom of God and reflecting that peace and that wholeness to a world who desperately needs to know you in reality. And we thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. So, we have communion. This is what this is really. Oh, first of all, does anybody need a communion cup? Raise your hand. Everybody's got them? Okay, I just wanted. Well, there's one. Jim in the back, they can get them. So, the night Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. You know, now, obviously, it hasn't happened in our study yet, but it will. And what I just taught you about the Lord's Prayer, everything about it, all the truths, come down to this. Jesus says, I can talk to you about knowing my dad's name is hallowed and thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I can teach you about, you know, give us our daily bread, forgive us our sins, you know, and help and lead us not in temptation, let us not be led into temptation. But it comes back to one thing. It's all done because of me. I did it for you. See, so you can read that stuff and you can take notes on it and you can feel frustrated that maybe you're not living at that level. But at the end of the day, you have to sit down and say, God, I can do this because of you. I came into this kingdom because of you. I'm established because of you, and I will mature because of you. And one day I will live with you forever in your presence. And it was all done because you were willing to give your body, not just in the physical act of being beaten and crucified, but in an offering for all the sins, forgivenesses of ourselves and others, of the whole world for all eternity. So when you eat, remember this is what Jesus gave us, and he said, eat this in remembrance of me. The same night evening, I guess, because they were going out to the garden, he took a glass of wine, which was common, and he said, so now I've established that your entrance into the kingdom is by me, and you should rejoice at that. But the next question you should ask is, how am I going to live it? I mean, you've set a high bar here. How am I going to become a kingdom person? He said by this, it's my blood that is perfect. I'm perfect. I have the Holy Spirit. I'm releasing the Holy Spirit to you, which will live with you forever. And I will be with you till the end of the age. I will not only forgive you, but I will empower you, change your thinking, and reveal truth to you because you are precious to me. Let us drink and let us remember. Now, when we pray, we're going to do the Lord's Prayer. Remember, please forgive us our failures as we forgive those who fail. We're just doing it this Sunday. It's not changing the Lord's Prayer. But think about what you're saying. Think about how powerful this. I look at the Lord's Prayer like an accordion. It's all compact. But when you start pulling it out, it's amazing what it does. So let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our failures as we forgive those who fail against us. And let us not be led into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. God bless you. You can, we're going to bypass praises, so you can, we're kind of running late.
Well, as we have said the Lord's prayers, we can say, I have a blessed assurance that the Lord is mine. Please stand and join us after having this communion and special time with the Lord. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation. Spirit,
John? Yes. Just remain standing. We're going to close right here. I just want to tell you a couple things. One, read your prayer request. Mary Lowe is going in for surgery. She had a bunch of biopsies, and they were all kind of benign, but there still is one pressing on her that they got to take out. So I'm sure Teresa will probably need some help taking meals to him. I don't know if Randy's the cook or not. So that would be it. The other thing to remember is fellowship hour and your offering. You know, we don't make a big thing about it. You can put them in the boxes. You can send it online. You can do whatever you want. But thank you for being faithful. And lastly, remember, we do need a choir for Christmas. You can see Marlene or Kathy if you're interested, so we can have a great celebration. We need to find places to celebrate all we can in how things are. So let's pray. God, we are grateful that your face shines upon us, that you bless us. Whether we go, are coming or going, you're there for us. You taught us not how, also how to hear your voice and to pray your prayers. Help us to continually seek your face and to know you as truth. Help us to be free, whole, and intimate with you, and let us bless others who desperately need to know how much God cares for them. Go in peace, go in protection, go in his authority. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.